Good evening, everyone. Welcome to tonight's prayer meeting. Thank you for joining us. My name is Craig Holiday, and I'm one of the associate pastors here at the Brooklyn Tabernacle. We're going to enter into a time of intercessory prayer for requests we receive from all over the world. And here at the Brooklyn Tabernacle, we take these requests seriously because there are people who believe and know that if they send in a request here to the Brooklyn Tabernacle, that there's a group of people in downtown Brooklyn that's going to be praying earnestly for those prayer requests. These requests will show up on your screen, followed by a time of praise and worship. So please, quiet your hearts, begin to intercede for those who have wrote in requests. God bless.
Amen. Let's continue to worship the Lord in song. We are going to bless His name today, church, for He's worthy. Thank you, Lord. We magnify Your name. We glorify You. Gracias, Señor. Oh, let's sing the first verse. Louder than the voice of fear. bless your name. Come on, let's bless the name of Jesus. For it reaches to the highest mountain, yes, Lord. And it flows to the glory. It's the blood of Jesus, oh.
Oh,
I hope you enjoyed that time of intercessory prayer where you could quiet your heart and intercede for those prayer requests that were scrolling across the screen. I also hope you enjoyed the praise and worship time, the opportunity to enter into the presence of the Lord and just lift up your voice wherever you might be, whether you're in your living room, whether you're in your car, whether you're gathered with some friends and family members. That time of praise and worship is very important. That's how we enter into the presence of the Lord. And so if you're looking for someone to pray with you or you need counsel, we have a team of people that's waiting to receive your call. And what you can do is you can call in to us at 718-290-2000, and someone will answer your call anytime between 9 and 5, Monday through Friday. That's 718-290-2000. Any day of the week, Monday through Friday, between 9 and 5, someone will be there to answer your call and pray with you. You won't get a recording, but you'll get a live person who will pray with you and counsel with you. Or you can send in a prayer request on our website. What you can do is go to our website, look for prayer request, and put in your prayer request, and those prayer requests will be prayed for 30 days by our prayer band. And so hopefully, if you need counseling or you need a prayer request, you can follow those two instructions. I want to encourage you because we've been so blessed to have members who have continuous to give and support this ministry here at the Brooklyn Tabernacle. And that's so very important because we are so much aware of the financial pinch that everyone's under right now with the economy and everything that's going on. But we thank God, all of our pastoral team, we pray for you and we thank God that you are continuously giving and supporting the ministry and the upkeep of everything that's going on here. But not only here, but also supporting the missionaries that depend on your giving so that they can continue with their feeding programs and everything else. And so thank you for being a cheerful giver because we know God loves a cheerful giver. And so I want to encourage you to do that, continue to do that. Tune into instructions on how you can give online in these times of absence on our website.
The Brooklyn Tabernacle has made giving simple through SecureGive. You now have three ways to give your tithes and offerings from the comfort of your home. You may use your cell phone to text BTGive and your gift amount to the number 74483. For example, to give $20, just text BTGIVE20 to 74483 or click the Give Now button on our website at giving.brooklyntabernacle.org or download the SecureGive app on your mobile device and enter the Brooklyn Tabernacle on the search screen. Please go to giving.brooklyntabernacle.org for more information.
Once again, thank you for all those who participate in giving. And so I wanted to encourage you in something from the Word of God tonight. And I'm mindful that with everything that's going on in our world and in our country, especially during this time of the elections, my prayer was that God would give me a word that would be in season, that would be relevant to everything that's going on right now. And so I chose to read from a passage of scripture that is well known. We've all heard it before. And it's from one of the epistles where it's in the New Testament, but it's considered the New Testament book of Proverbs by a lot of commentators because it's practical teaching. It's in the epistle of James. And James writes to a bunch of folks who are being scattered and persecuted. And so I love the book of James because it just has practical teaching for us to go by. And so I wanted to share from there and wanted to take some thoughts from these verses and just see how we can apply them to our lives in a practical way during this season of our lives. And so I'm going to be reading from James chapter 1, verses 19 through 20 in the Amplified Bible. And it reads like this. Understand this, my beloved brothers and sisters. Let everyone be quick to hear, be a careful, thoughtful listener, slow to speak, a speaker of careful, chosen words, and slow to get angry, patient, reflective, forgiving. For the resentful, deep-seated anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God, that standard of behavior which he requires for us. I love that because it's as if James is writing a Proverbs and he hits on three key notes in verse 19. He says, be quick to hear. Or in some translations, it says, be eager to hear. In other words, what James is saying is, be thoughtful in your hearing. He says, be careful and thoughtful in your hearing. And the thing right now is, with all the noise that's out there when it comes to the media, social media, and everything else that's being played out there, what James is getting to is being a hearer of the Word of God, understanding what you're hearing. And how does it line up, or how is it in harmony with God's Word? Just for a nugget of truth is this. Unless I know God's Word, I won't know what's out there that's being produced or put out there that's hearsay. And so James says, be eager to hear. Hear God's Word. Why? Because there's so much out there. But not only hearing God's Word, I like to take another cut at this as well, is listening to others. Because when we take the time out to listen to others, and I'm not talking about hearing, I'm talking about actively listening, it shows our concerns. It shows that that person or that individual is important. It also shows that we have compassion because we want to understand why they feel the way they feel or they see things the way they see things. In doing that, we are fulfilling God's commandment. We're loving our brothers and sisters as we love ourselves because each and every one of us wants to be heard. Listening is not an easy skill. It's something that needs to be developed by all of us. Some people are great listeners. Some people don't listen to anyone. They just want to project their own thoughts, their own opinions. But the only way we can move forward in anything we want to do is being able to be hearers. Why? Because being a hearer and a listener shows that we have a teachable spirit. We're willing to learn. We realize that we don't know everything. We haven't cornered the market on intelligence because there are things that we don't know and we all have blind spots. And so James says, be eager to hear. But he also says this, he says, slow to speak. Slow to speak. Chosen words, carefully chosen words. You know, the Bible says in Proverbs, it says that it's a wise man or woman who considers their words. Why would they consider their words? Because Proverbs also say words have the power of life and death. So if I'm considering my words, I'm considering, am I speaking life into a situation or am I speaking death into a situation? Because I understand that my words do have the power of life and death. And so I'm considering my words. Are they accomplishing what God wants me to accomplish? And are my motives behind my words aligned or in harmony with what God says in his word? And so he says, be slow to speak. You know, the Bible also says in Proverbs, it says, it's a soft answer that turns away wrath. How can I give a soft answer if I'm not considering what I'm saying? And so that just expresses wisdom. And because I'm able to consider what I'm saying, when I respond to someone that's showing wrath towards me, I can diffuse the situation in such a way that now that person and I can have a conversation or discussion. Now, I get it. You might be sitting there saying, but Craig, you don't know. Some people will not be open to listening. That's true. The Bible also says it's a fool that gives full vent to their rage. I didn't call him a fool, but the Bible says that. And so you have to realize when you're dealing with someone who is not open to having a conversation or discussion, a meaningful one, and you're not open to listening to each other, what happens is, yeah, it won't be a fruitful conversation. But you being the wise person, the godly person, the person who is spirit-filled and spirit-led and walking the way God has called you to walk, you begin to diffuse the situation. And sometimes you just have to walk away from a conversation that's not beneficial to you or to the other individual. But he also says this, be slow to anger. Slow to anger. Not only eager to hear what's being said, not only being slow to speak and considering what you're getting ready to say, but also being slow to anger. Why? Because when we look around, everything that's going on right now in our country, this hate-filled, angry-filled, bitter country that we're dealing with right now, and that's a reality. There's so many angry people. So many people who just want to be heard but don't want to listen to anyone else. And so James says, be slow to anger. He says this, being patient, reflective, and forgiving. Patient in love. Now, all of us like to quote the love chapter. We all know the love chapter. If you're a believer, you know what the love chapter is. 1 Corinthians 13, right? I love the fact that Paul says, love is patient. Because we know, he says, love is patient, love is kind, love is long-suffering, and forgives all wrongs. And I believe, personally, this is my own personal take, unless I have the love of Christ working in me and that patience that he has towards me, that I can show that towards other, there's no way I can be kind. There's no way I can be long-suffering. There's no way I can be forgiven. I can't forgive wrongs. Why? Because even Proverbs says it's a wise man who overlooks an offense. It's a wise man who can overlook an offense. Why? Because that wise man has insight. He has understanding. He walks in knowledge. And so even when someone offends him, he doesn't have to get angry. He or she does not have to get angry. Yes, and some people will retort and say, well, Craig, there's a righteous anger. Yeah, but the Bible also says, be angry, but don't sin. We know that. But we see people out there being angry that's professing the name of Christ, and they're out there committing sin because of what's going on in their hearts. And so we have to realize, as we walk and we say that we are believers in Christ, that Jesus died for us, we believe that in our hearts and confess it with our mouths. There's a standard that God has called us to live by as believers. And yes, you might be sitting there saying, well, you know what, Craig? You don't understand some of the stuff that has happened to me. That's true. We all have a different story. We all have a different story, but we all serve the same Christ. And the thing is if we're going to serve Christ and we're going to live for Christ, we have to understand there's a standard that God has called us to live by. There's a game plan that God has called us to play by. And that game plan is his word, the Bible. He's called us to play the game of life according to his word. His word is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. It is not going to change. His standard is not going to change. God will not lower the bar for any of us. He's called us to live a certain way. And when we live outside of that way, and yes, I know that there's people who will take the word of God and use it as a buffet table. They will pick and choose whatever verses that suits their lifestyle. However, they will have to give an account for that as well. They will have to give an account for that as well. Because why? Our God is so sovereign and he's so patient, he gives warning signs to even to those who are using his word in the wrong way. But verse 19, 20 says this, excuse me. It says, for the resentful, deep-seated anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. It does not produce God's righteousness. If I'm walking around in anger, bitterness, resentment, and that's being shown, but I'm saying I'm living for Christ, it is not producing the righteousness of God. And it is not as even producing the measure of life that God has placed on my life and everyone else who profess to be a Christian. God has called us to live a certain way. He's called us to live a certain way. Righteousness and justice are his twin towers. And so we have to walk in righteousness. We have to walk in justice. God has called us to walk that way. He's called us to live that way. And he's not changing that. And yes, when we see unjust practices, we are to speak up. We are to talk about these things. We are to have a conversation. Conversation. Interesting. Because that's what James is getting at. Being eager to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry, you can have a real conversation. And that's what James is getting at there. But he says this, it doesn't produce the righteousness of God. That standard of behavior which he requires from us. There's a standard that God has required from each and every one of us. He requires it from us. Why? Because we say that we wear the colors of the cross. We say that we play for Team Jesus. And right now, unfortunately, if I can use sports vernacular, it looks like our locker room is divided. And it's divided because we've allowed so much to divide us. We've allowed the racial wall within our locker room to go higher. Economics and everything else, our political views, has created division in the body of Christ. It has always created division. And my prayer is that we will begin to address those divisions that have been created. But ultimately, we can't complain about what the world is doing. We have to be more concerned about what the church is doing, because we say that we are part of the church and we are the body of Christ. And so I can only imagine how this must grieve the Lord's heart, that he would die on a cross for each and every one of us in such a way to forgive us of our sins, and we can't get it right here on earth and have heaven on earth here. And so he says there's a standard. And if you want to know what that standard is, I think Jesus summed it up very well when he was approached by the lawyer. We know in the Gospels, the lawyer comes to Jesus and says, "How do I get eternal life?" And Jesus says, "Here's the greatest commandment of all. Love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as you love yourself." That's the standard. That's the standard that God has called each and every one of us to live by. First and foremost, loving the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. But also, I have to love my neighbor as I love myself. And my neighbor isn't just the people who look like me. My neighbor isn't the people who just live in my community. My neighbor isn't just the people who are in the same economic status that I'm in. My neighbor isn't the people who just go to the same places I go to. What Jesus is getting at is my neighbor is a global neighbor. It's everyone who was made in God's image, and that's each and every one of us. We were all made in God's image. And so that's who my neighbor is. And God has called each and every one of us to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. So let's take a page out of God's playbook. Let's be eager to listen. Listen. Listening to God's word, studying God's word, applying God's word, letting God's word be the lenses in which we view life through. Let's be slow to speak, considering what we're saying, knowing that our words have the power of life and death. And it's a wise person who considers their words. And let's be slow to get angry. Why? Because we know we serve a God that his anger is his strange action. And so we should be following the same suit as God, our Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ, being spirit-filled and spirit-led. Because when we get angry and we go out there and we bicker and fight and everything else, that's not the spirit of God. That's the flesh. That's the flesh. There's a standard that God has called each and every one of us to live by. And it starts with us, first and foremost, having that vertical love for God so that he might impart in us the horizontal love for one another. That's my prayer for each and every one of us during this season. That not only individually, but corporately, because it's going to take us to do this corporately, to change the landscape. This is not a cultural war. This is a sin war. It's a sin war. It's a sin war. And so the gates of hell will not prevail when God's people unite and begin to bring heaven here on earth. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, that it does cut like a two-edged sword through the bone, through the marrow, through the flesh of men and women. And Lord, I just pray that each and every one of us will take to heart your words that you are anointed the Apostle James to write. All of us being eager to listen, spending time in your word, studying it for ourselves to show ourselves approved, but also knowing when we hear heresy, wrong doctrine, wrong theology. And Father, help us to be slow to speak, understanding, Lord, that our words do matter. Our words can either speak life or speak death in a situation. So help us to be more conscious of the words we use, O Lord. And Father, I pray, Lord, that each and every one of us, Lord, will be slow to anger. God, because the anger of man doesn't produce the righteousness of you. And so, Lord, I pray that we would walk in these precepts. We would walk, oh God, in these principles, oh Lord. Because, Lord, you have called us to live by a standard. And, Lord, you are not going to change the standard, oh God. You have called us to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. But you've also called us to love one another as we love ourselves. And, Lord, you're not going to change that. You have called us to that. And so, Father, I just pray, Lord, that if there's anyone within the sound of my voice, oh God, that is struggling in that area, oh God, that you would give them the grace, your enabling power, oh God, to be able to do the things that they can't do in their own strength, oh God. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would touch the hearts of those who are embittered right now, oh God. I pray, Lord, that you would touch the hearts of those, oh God, who are not looking at life through the lenses of your word, oh God, that they would get a thirst and hunger for your word. And Lord, I pray by your spirit, Lord, that you would begin to move on the hearts of your people who are called by your name, and that we would humble ourselves and come to you and repent of our sins and our transgressions so that you might be able to not only heal our hearts, but heal our land. And so, God, I thank you. I thank you, Lord, because you're a God that not only hears, but you're a God who responds. And so, Lord, I thank you and I praise you. In Jesus the Christ's name we pray. Amen. And so now we're going to have a time of prayer. We're going to play some music. And you can sit there for the next 10 minutes and just pray about what you heard and find out and see how God wants to deal with you in these days to come. God bless you. Have a good evening.